समप्रभ
कोटि सूर्य समप्रभ
निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव
निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव
सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा
सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा
सर्वेऽपि सुखिनः सन्तु
सर्वेऽपि सुखिनः सन्तु
सर्वे सन्तु निरामया
सर्वे सन्तु निरामया
सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु
सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु
मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत्
मा कश्चित् दुःखभाग् भवेत् सह वीर्यं करवावहै
तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै
तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै
शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति
ॐ शान्ति 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 शान्ति
We God protect us all and inspire us to enjoy the divinity within each one of us and all around us. May our studies this morning become enlightening and take the darkness of ignorance away. May we love one another, never fight. Peace, peace, peace unto all today. Today is the month of Vaishakh, first fortnight, seventh day. It is one of the auspicious days of the month. Today is April 25th. Yesterday, Friday, was the birthday of Swami Ramanujacharya. And the day before that was the birthday of Shankaracharya. And coming week on Wednesday is Mohini Ekadashi. It is important to spend a couple of minutes talking about these two scholars, Shankaracharya, who lived in the 8th century and for a very small while, less than 40 years. And Ramanujacharya, who lived much longer, but in the 17 was his birthday. And they follow a certain kind of philosophy. Shankaracharya that we personally follow represents Advaita. Advaita means everything is exactly the same. God is both immanent, transcendent, permeates to everything. There is no difference whatsoever. It is our ignorance that makes us think there is something different. Advaita philosophy is there is a God sitting somewhere else and we are same. But Ramanujacharya, who is given the credit for this Vishishta Advaita, is actually following the teachings of several other scholars before him. But his book has survived, and that's why he is given the preeminent place in Vishishta Advaita. And that can be called as a qualified monism, qualified non-dualism, attributive monism. And these words are very confusing. If we want to understand in simple terminology, Shankaracharya Advaita means Brahman is everything. Ramanujacharya Vishishta Advaita, herein he divides between the sentient beings and non-sentient beings and tries to differentiate to a certain degree. What it says that Brahman is everything that is given. But it says within Brahman itself, there is a complex distribution of one which is living, Chetas, and one which is not living, Achetas. And that's what the combination is. Shankaracharya says that everything is Brahman, whether it is sentient or not. Only thing is, to me, from the practical point of view, it makes very little difference if you understand the details of it. As long as we understand that there is nothing but Brahman, then we have understood the meaning completely of all these philosophies. This one I would rather leave it for the academicians to dissect it and further dissect it. But if anybody had a question, I can discuss with you in greater detail at the end. But to me, it was important to mention this minor difference because of the recent birthdays of Shankaracharya and Ramanujacharya.
Shishi?
Yeah.
One thing that Ramanujacharya emphasized is the bhakti of surrender. Mm-hmm. And if you dig deeply into Shankara's philosophy, the question comes out, who is surrendering to whom?
He's come to today's discussion.
So,
This will come in today's discussion.
Yeah.
So it will go connected to exactly that.
So there is that small division.
Yeah. I think as a matter of fact,
when the enlightenment comes, there is no division.
I think the thing is, what Ramanujacharya and many of his predecessors have discussed is that when we take the word in its entirety, Aham Brahmasmi, there is a possibility that the person who is really enlightened might get to his head and will start behaving in an irrational way. In order to avoid that, he wanted to make it separate. That's my judgment as far as I'm concerned. But as long as we realize that even when you get the knowledge, that person with the knowledge has to still remain grounded in such a way, haranti prasadamam mana, that enlightened mind can be taken away in the wrong direction if person does not remain grounded in the understanding of Brahman. So that has been described. But in order that an average person understands it, it is divided in this little minor subtle way. Other thing, if you want to go into detail, is as far as Ramanujacharya was concerned, he insisted that Brahman has to be Sagun Brahman. So he insisted having Murti. Whereas Shankaracharya has contended that whether you have Murti or not Murti, everything is divine. That's the only difference. So Ramanujacharya basically insisted on having a Murti and then talked about various ways how the Murti becomes an avatara and so on and so forth. And again, to go further, Ramanujacharya and his predecessors felt that the only deity existent which is really God was Vishnu. So that's very Vaishnava tradition. And to me that is very limited in my opinion. That's why we belong to Shankaracharya, because as far as I'm concerned, you really cannot say that only one particular manifestation of divinity is the ultimate. And the same philosophy was picked up by the Swaminarayan temple people as well, following Vaishnava tradition. But since you wanted to talk about it, I mentioned that. Today, we're going to discuss about at least first part of the enlightened devotee, and how much we go depends upon the time and the question answers that we want to address at the end. When we're talking about an enlightened devotee, having absolute Shraddha and utmost devotion are the two ingredients in that recipe, essentially. And these two ingredients are absolutely essential in order that we achieve the fourth purushartha in our life. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha. The fourth purushartha. The two ingredients of your recipe is absolute Shraddha and utmost devotion. Shraddha and Bhakti. How do you translate Shraddha? As we had discussed before, it just cannot be translated by a single word in English. The best one can do is describe what Shraddha is. And the way I describe Shraddha is, Shraddha means absolute confidence in what you're listening. Utmost sincerity to pursue God, understanding what God is. Intense longing to reach that particular goal. Positive outlook that yes, I will accomplish it. And in general, not bringing any negative thoughts in your mind. Because if you go with a constant support, encouragement of your teachers, friends, family, that you'll be able to accomplish a particular task, the chances of you accomplishing is much greater than you start with a negative feeling, I don't think I'm going to make it. and trust me, you are not going to make it. So the Shraddha means you have to have a positive outlook, absolute confidence you can accomplish it, and it doesn't come overnight. You can't just sit on your bed expecting Narayana is going to come and give you everything handed to you. You have to make constant personal efforts to achieve that goal. But go with the confidence that if you pursue that particular goal with utmost desire and drive, you'll be able to achieve. So that's Shraddha. Now, when we were talking about who are the bhaktas, Sri Krishna described in the 16th verse of the 7th chapter, Chaturvidha bhajante maam janaha sukritor janurna sukritir norjuna sukritanaha arjuna arto jidnyasu rarthati jnani cha bharatarshava. Because of grasasu grama, that's why the word gets combined. So basically those are artha, jidnyasu, artharthi and jnani. Who are artha? Artha are the ones who are in distress. They typically cry out for God when they are in difficulty. Like we going to do the prayer before the examinations come. Otherwise nobody remembers the God. Before you go for the interview, go and do the prayers. You get difficulties, oh God, what am I going to do now? That is artha. Typical reaction most of us. The second one is jidnyasu. Jidnyasu means he has got, rather than jidnyasu, I'll take artharthi first. Artharthi is a typical common man like you and me. We want to seek security and pleasure, kama and artha. So artharthi, artha includes both kama and artha. So we want to make money, we want to have pleasures, so do the Satyanarayana puja, so that I get some particular outcome positive. So that is artharthi. Many of the rituals which are done as artharthi. So, as a matter of fact, if you go with that attitude, that would be artharthi. But at the end of every puja, like as we finish the singing of the verses, Shri Krishna Arpanamastu. So even that prasad that we are getting, the outcome, positive outcome that is coming, we are offering back to God. That is the correct way of doing the prayers. So if the rituals are done for the purpose of doing rituals and not asking for anything particular, then I think those are appropriate. But if it is done because I would expect to get something out of it, then I think it loses its real brightness, loses its color, becomes a little tainted. So we talked about artha, calling when they are in distress, artharthi, trying to get certain positive outcome in the form of security or pleasure. Third thing is all of us here who are kind of desirous to know me, mumukshu, jidnyasu. So basically are really want to know what is this life all about, who am I, why the heck I was born as a human being. So that inquisitiveness, trying to find out, like the salmon going back to Alaska, trying to find the roots, that is exactly we're talking about, jidnyasu, mumukshu. And the ultimate group is jnani, one who are enlightened, and they do the prayers because they recognize the value of doing the puja, while you are doing the prayers. Now what I'm talking about, if you understand that these four type of people do that, then it is very clear you don't need to split between the hair here, trying to say that you have to have chetas and achetas. You don't need to shish that word. You can understand. You can be four different kinds. And the jnani has to continue doing the prayers to remain grounded the way it should be. And then he continues the very next verse. He says, Tesha jnani nitya yukta eka bhaktir vishishyate priyohi jnananurthartam aham sacha metriya. So he says, among these, jnani always united with me his devotion resolved in oneness is distinguished, special, extraordinary special. I'm very much dear to him, and he's also dear to me in the knowledge of his own nature. So Sri Krishna in these two verses has talked about who are the people who are doing the prayers, the bhaktas, and classified them, clarifying as to who is the jnani, who is closest to him. Now, qualities of a good devotee, true devotee, have come up in several locations in Gita. But however, they are best summarized in seven verses, starting with the 13th verse of the 12th chapter, called Bhakti Yoga. And then he continues to outline 39 total qualities of a perfect devotee and who calls very dear to me. I'll tell you honestly, I was really angry with one of the teachers who came to town. It was about at least 40 years ago. And I asked him to explain to me a God who is impartial to everybody. Why should Sri Krishna say that this particular devotee is favorite of mine? I mean, it's a basic question. He was translating the verse word by word. Sacha bhakta mama priya. I said, explain to me. What that gentleman did, he got angry and he left. Have you read Gita? I said, yes, I have read many times, but I'm not very clear, so why do you explain? You are asking in a very nice and appropriate way, in my opinion. But he felt that either he couldn't answer it, or he felt that how can somebody challenge him on that particular translation? I said, this is a translation, but explain to me what it means. But again, I still thank him greatly, because he insisted that he was not going to explain. So that forced me to continue to study in greater detail from different sources to try to understand what is Sri Krishna trying to say if that particular devotee is favorite of mine. Then I came to realize that this devotee is referring to is not an ordinary devotee, but a special devotee who makes no distinction between himself and Ishwara. He is no longer overcome with ignorance, but instead is enlightened. He has accomplished what is needed to be accomplished, that is Krita Kritya. He in reality was already accomplished at birth, but he knew it not. But in his life, by doing various important activities, penance, persistent studies, following the teachers, studying, was able to accomplish which was already accomplished, but he knew it not. So when he's talking about he is dear to me, he meant he is no different than me. He is not away from me. He is with me because he knows that our nature is exactly identical. That was the meaning I was trying to understand when I asked the question about 40 plus years ago. But that's the way I understand.
There is no other.
No other, exactly. Now, when you say this enlightened devotee has found fulfillment by knowing by nature he is free from any limitations, he is whole, purna. There is no vagueness in his understanding about his true nature. He is full of ananda, meaning that he is overflowing with all varieties of positive emotions. He always expresses love, the basic emotion that gets modified into many qualities, including caring, compassion, friendliness, etc. So that is the meaning, that the particular bhakta is a favorite of mine. Let's start with this verse. Follow me, please. Advaishta sarva bhutana.
Advaishta sarva bhutana.
Maitra karunae vacha.
Maitra karunae vacha.
Nirmamo nirahankara. I'll translate the whole thing and then I'll take one phrase at a time. One who has no hatred or ill will for all beings. one who has disposition of a friend, one who is compassionate and indeed free from possessiveness or sense of ownership of anything, free from the I notions or sense of ego, equal in mental disposition in pleasant and unpleasant circumstances, one who is naturally accommodative, that particular bhakta is a favorite of mine, is no different than that. Let's take one phrase at a time. One who has no hatred or ill will towards none, adveshta. It's one of the most important qualities, adveshta. Now, he has no hatred towards anyone, including the person who is causing him harm. An interesting story that comes up is, one Lama comes to Dalai Lama asking for forgiveness from him because he had not done the proper thing on the previous day. And what was he asking forgiveness from Dalai Lama? He was getting angry with himself because he was getting angry with the person who was torturing him. And he was upset with himself that he was getting angry with the guy who was torturing him badly. And he was mad because he should not have gotten angry. So he was asking for forgiveness. So when you're talking about not hatred, you have to still express the kind of love even for a person who's torturing. That is a true understanding of Advaita. Now, the same thing should apply to a person who is insulting you, hurting you, cheating you, disappointing you. You still have to make sure that you don't hate or get angry with that particular person. Now, if you remember a story I read many years ago, was at the banks of river Ganges, the teacher had just finished talking about Advaita to his disciples. And the disciple accepted his teaching to the fullest extent. And finally came to the teacher asking for clarification. He said, "I was sitting on the banks of the river, and I know you have taught us that life is precious. You have to save every life that you possibly can. And I saw a scorpion fall down in the water and I knew it would drown. So I pulled it up and put it on the side. In that process, he stung me. Again he fell in the water. Again he stung me. Went down half a dozen times. I don't understand what you taught me. Did I do something wrong?" The teacher said, "I'm glad you did it. You express your nature of love, compassion, caring, saving life. And scorpion expresses its own nature of stinging you. So there's nothing wrong with it. Everybody was doing whatever their natures are. There's nothing wrong in protecting yourself by putting on the gloves before you begin. But what you did is absolutely right." So I think that is important to remember, that only person we can really change is ourselves, not anybody else. In that process, you have to do what is best. And if you understand who you really are, what your true nature are, love, compassion, caring, protecting the life, and never hating anybody, is your integral part of your personality.
So this person who picked up the scorpion was a Samadarshi. Uh-huh. But he was not a Samavarti. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why he got picked.
Yeah. The second thing to remember is a simple example. If you go to emergency room, two patients have been brought in the emergency room with gunshot wounds. Of course, you know, everybody must have guns, guys. That's the way to improve safety, but that's a different discussion. One person the doctor was treating with great care and compassion, was a person who was shot by the robber in his home. He was brought by ambulance to the emergency room. And when 911 calls came, the police ran to that place and shot the robber, and that also was brought to the emergency room. But both those individuals, the robber who was shot because he was stealing, and the poor guy whose house was being robbed and shot by the robber, were treated with equal care by the same doctor. That is what I'm talking about. Not looking as to what particular thing he did, but your responsibility as an objective evaluator and performer is to take care of the equally. Just because he shot that poor guy, that doesn't mean the doctor is not going to take care of this guy who shot him. That's what I'm talking about, understanding as to what needs to be done. You can always find at least one good quality in every individual and make sure that for that reason you would not hate him, rather love him. You remember the story of Rajasri Yajna? They had instructed the two eldest sons in two different branches of that kshetra, Yudhishthir and Duryodhana. Find out a person who is most ideally suited to be recognized at the end of the Rajasri Yajna, most to be honored. Bring him or bring his name, then you can send him the email afterwards and invite him. And both of them showed up. And the answer was, they could not come up with any name. Because Yudhishthir said, I found everybody who is qualified to win the prize. Because he found the good quality in everybody. And Duryodhan could not find a single person. Because he always found out something or the other, not quite perfect in that. So he didn't come up with it. So it depends on how you look at it. But the key is to recognize that every individual has at least one good quality in him or her, and recognize that individual for that, and love balanced way, just the way God does. And the same thing happened in the nature. The rain doesn't fall only on the rich person's house. What I'm trying to say is that natural elements treat everybody equally, regardless of the position in the society or the money that is kept hoarded in the banks without sharing with others. Yes, sir.
I think it's important to understand that Vaishnava means not just an external hating, I hate you, not even to entertain the thought of harming the other person. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's important.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Because hate usually harbors in your mind, it multiplies. Mm-hmm. For a period of time, you act, but you don't even entertain the thought.
Exactly. Advaita is basically one who has that true value of love, compassion, and with that kind of a positive feeling, she can never reach the level of hating anybody. So that's why whenever I translate the Sarana Vavatu, I just don't say hate or fight, but basically love one another. That's the correct way of translating that particular beginning. We can go on Advaita for a long time, but we'll go on to the second thing, because there are about seven qualities described in just one verse here. Second one is Maitra, state of being a friend, friendliness towards all. This is not simply a quality. Such an individual has a total awareness of oneness towards all, which leads to friendliness. He's really a friend of the entire world. The correct word for that is Jaganmitra. I think Arun, you had asked me one question when you were asking me 3-4 years ago. Ayam nijaha parovetti ganana lagu chetasam udara charitanam tu vasudhaiva kutumbakam. This is mine. This is somebody else's. This child is mine. This is Karatatu Shresa, somebody else's. So I'm not going to worry about it. That is a feeling that belongs to those who are narrow-minded. But for those magnanimous individuals with large hearts, and not that doctors were describing large heart, not a large heart, generous heart, the entire world becomes a family. We taught the word Vasudeva Kutumbakam, but I think the important thing is to remember Adveshta Sarva Bhutanam, Ayam Nijaha Paro Veti, Ganana Laghu Chetasam, Udara Chaitanam Du Vasudeva. Now, Patanjali described four subjects: Maitri Karuna Mudito Pekshanam, Sukha Dukkha Punya Punna Vishayanam, Bhavanaschita Prasadanam. In Yoga Shastra 133, he describes there are four subjects: Sukha, Dukkha, Punya, and Papa. That means joy, grief, good and bad. Four kinds of emotions: Maitri, Karuna, Mudita, Upeksha. Friendship, compassion, happiness, neglect. Now, feeling oneness with others makes one happy with other people's accomplishments and successes instead of jealousy. So, when the neighbor's child wins a prize, we should be all celebrating, rather than being jealous about it. But feeling the oneness with others, you are very happy about it. When your children or grandchildren do well, we are happy in the family. But somebody else's child or grandchild does, unless you have understanding of this, you don't. So when we celebrate success of our community members, we should rejoice rather than getting jealous. That's a part of understanding here. So this kind of understanding and unconditional leads to be gradually extended to the family members or community, country, and then for the entire world. Start with the family, it's okay. But then extend it. That's what for us, Kumar and I, myself, for us this temple community becomes family ourselves. When we worked in the hospital, hospital community was a part of the family. They were felt anything different. We have to keep on enlarging our vision to accept everybody with the same kind of love and compassion. Similarly, if one sees the suffering in others, the feeling of compassion must spontaneously rise in one's mind without any attempts to place blames on someone. Even if one knows the immediate cause of the suffering, the emotion must be nothing but compassion. I've given you an example before. Auntie is doing the babysitting. Mom had to go to do something else. And the babysitter said, please, don't run around too much, you'll fall down. The staircase is right there, don't go. And once you tell a toddler not to do something, you know what the natural reaction is. And when the toddler tumbles down that staircase and falls and cries, the caretaker doesn't have to say, I told you, you should do that, that's why you fell down. That is not the reaction which is correct. Your responsibility is to make sure that you run down quickly to the child and comfort that child. Even though you know why it happened, when somebody transgressed what was told, and it happened because of that, for example, when Lakshman Resha was drawn, and Sita stepped on the line and suffered the consequences of it, you can't keep on blaming Sita, so I'm not going to help you. But go ahead and make sure the things are rectified to the best possible extent. Now, if we consider the bad outcome is the result of a bad or immoral act, one must not again keep on dwelling on it. I talked about the child. But in the medical field, we know the patient coming with HIV is either an addict or some unusual sexual orientation, which increases the frequency of HIV infections. But somebody comes to us with that particular problem, the only thing that we can think about is to help the person. So that is exactly what is important, Maitraha. And the person why That person has a true compassion of a dear friend, because helping oneself is not a big deal. Everybody does that. But if you consider somebody else different than you, then you're afraid of him, I may not be able to help him. So that word that we use frequently is dvitiyat bhayam. Because if we consider aham nija paro veti, that means too different, then that kind of help may not be coming. We can keep on going as far as maitra is concerned. The third quality is karunaha. Yes, brother.
Excuse me for interrupting.
No, that's fine.
The thoughts came to me. I look at this verse, in two ways Krishna is telling. Mm-hmm. A bhakta is endowed with maitri, is free from dvesha. Mm-hmm. So it's not enough to say, I don't hate anybody. Mm-hmm. It is important to say, I love everybody. Exactly. So Krishna is making that very clear. Is endowed with maitri, is free from dvesha.
As a matter of fact, Prasanna, all these 39 virtues are all interrelated.
Yeah.
And as a matter of fact, the one word that comes up somewhere down the road in those verses is satatam.
Yeah.
But really speaking, that satatam applies to all 39. You're absolutely right. They're all interconnected. Advaita, maitri, absolutely right.
Always.
The third one is karuna. Since such an enlightened devotee knows his true nature, he can condone individual's acts of omissions or commission, because his inherent anand is expressed through love and friendliness and takes a form of sympathy for those who are in pain, in agony or in suffering. That's why one who is enlightened, one who is the true bhakta, who is no different than Ishwara itself, the kind of compassion or karuna that he has is unrivaled altogether. And we know for certain that if that person was to be approached by anybody, regardless of his behavioral pattern, that person with compassion, karuna, is going to forgive him. So if you remember, at the end of every puja, we sing a particular verse. We acknowledge our weaknesses and ask for forgiveness, knowing fully the divinity which is all compassionate and loving and caring and loving is going to forgive us. Typical verse, if you remember it, mantrahinam kriyahinam bhaktihinam janadana yat pujitam mayadeva paripurnam kurushvadaya aparada sahasrani kriyante aranisham maya tasmat karunya bhavena kshamasva parmeshwara kshamasva parmeshwara. The great part about it is that great part for us as devotees is that God is going to be still looking at us with kindness. But what God expects us to do is pursue with persistence to reach the state of perfection. So that is what you need to do. So you're talking about, so far so we finished Advaita, Maitra and Karuna. Again, we are not even finished the first words. The fourth one is free from possessiveness or sense of ownership of anything. Near Mama. We are told it many times. We know that nothing is owned by us. Even there's a body, this particular body of mine, I don't own it. There are so many stakeholders who claim to my body, including the ancestral estate of various bacteria in my body. So I know that only thing that I have been offered in this life is trusteeship for a certain period of time. And my response is to take the best care of that, whatever I can. And as I shared with you before, when I checked with the authorities, I asked them what I can carry on, how much weight can I carry on, or how much is the checked-in baggage. They said, Air Brahman, nothing can be, no carry-on, and no checked-in baggage. So basically, we came here with nothing, and that's the way we're going to go. So we have to remember that we have been given the trusteeship privilege of enjoying what we have, and we own absolutely nothing. I mean, we think, Ram thinks that he owns that house, but actually it's owned by squirrels and birds and everybody else. Whether you invited them or not, they know that's theirs. In front of our house, geese come, generations after generations come. The same geese is great-great-grand geese is who my mother fed 40 years ago, still come back to say hello. What I'm trying to say is, that's their ancestral home, and not my home. So that's something to be remembered. Now, we talked about four different kinds of bhaktas. And the fourth one, of course, the most important, jnani. And a person who realizes that nothing really belongs to oneself, we've been just offered, bestowed upon us to enjoy. When somebody asks for a boon, the enlightened person answers in a much different way. Kunti, who suffered a life of hard life, really, going through the various things, I don't have to summarize them, she still took care of Dhritarashtra and Gandhari after the war was over. She was in the palace at that time. But when Gandhari and Dhritarashtra felt that it was about time for them to move on to Kathmandu, don't go there tonight, today's morning, I'm sorry, I'm sure everybody must have heard about it. She walked, said, I'm going to come out. I'm going to go there and do the penance myself. And Draupadi, Subhadra, everybody said, please stay back. Continue the blessings. Do the penance here to get you a place. But don't go with them. So no, I still have to go and serve them because they need help. I'm health-wise better than they are. So I want to go and help them. And Sri Krishna was watching. And he was giving blessings to everybody. And asked Kunti, what boon would you like? How should I bless you? She's an enlightened individual and she said, Svakarma phala nirishtam yam yam yonim vrajamyam tasyam tasyam rishikesha tvai bhaktir dudhastame. She said, based upon all the action that I've done in my life, whatever life cycles I go through, whatever yoni I go through, in each of that birth, hey Rishikesha, hey Shri Krishna, give me the blessings that my devotion to you, my bhakti to you, will be always solid. So she's asking for a blessing that may you bless me so that I remain totally devoted to you, regardless the life cycles I go through in the coming life forms. That is an enlightened devotee. So that's a perfect example to find out who really understands Nirmamana. The fifth virtue we're discussing this morning, the same verse, is free from I notion or sense of ego, Nirahankara. Now, this person who has reached that level of understanding really knows his akarta. If somebody says you did something, congratulations, and you take those congratulations, that means you really don't understand it. If you, the thing happened through you, you just have to recognize that you're the privileged individual through whom the thing got done by God. Karta Karavita is Bhagwan. God only is the one who does it. He chooses various individuals to carry out his function. And a person who is Nirahankari recognizes that he is simply an agent, not a true person who is doing it. He is the lucky guy who gets the opportunity to do that, and he doesn't have any I notion whatsoever. Because the other side of the Nirahankar coin is Ishwara Arpana Buddhi. Ishwara Arpana, that means everything that is done is offered to Bhagavan. See, Tyagat Shanti Nirantara. You see, goes through the Abhyasa, Jnana, Dhyana. But even when you accomplish Karma Phala Tyaga, but even those karma that you did based upon the inspiration of your guidance from God, you offer it to Ishwara because you know for certain who was the driving force behind it. Look at this temple. Our community is so lucky. So I have a place like this, but I can tell you with absolute personal experience, this place would not be there. And there's so many different people through whom God made sure that we were given all the opportunities to follow through. So we can't thank enough. So to Nirahankara, other side is Ishwara Arpan Buddhi. The next one you can go because you have to finish 39 qualities is Samasukha Dukha Kshami. Equal in mental disposition in pleasant and unpleasant circumstances. You see, once you realize everything is only one, that delusion of duality is gone. So Dvaita is thrown away. Tatra ko moha kaha shoka ekatvam anupashyata. Once you see unity in everything, then you don't have any delusion and you don't feel sorry about it. Now, we can go through various dvandvas, heart and cold, pleasure and pain, insult and praise, all those things, happiness and joyous thing and painful things. It's not that you're dead. It's not that you don't feel it. But how you react to those situations makes a difference. Samasukha, that means it's balanced. Those who are in the finance market, you understand, the beta is low. The beta is very small. It's not a huge fluctuation in the stock market. So he's Samasukha Dukha Sami. That means he understands, yes, it is pleasurable. But I'm not going to go and burn the cars after the Super Bowl is won by many people. And I'm not going to go and destroy something when something painful happens. So in balance in your reaction, balance equal in mental disposition, in pleasant and unpleasant circumstances. That is the simple thing about describing about Samasukha Dukha Kshami. And finally, I'll finish the seventh word, seventh quality and then stop. That is naturally accommodative and not simply forgiving. Kshami. Now, this quality allows one to remain composed, forgiving, and supporting even when under the hostile situation or being victimized. Simple thing is, remember our temple was vandalized. 11 statues were desecrated having gone through the Dhanyan Snan, gone through the first step of sanctification. But once you have the oneness feeling with everybody, regardless what they have done, what you separate with actor and the action, their action is totally unacceptable, for which they had to have certain punishment. But as individuals, they were no different than each one of us. They had the same divine potential as we do. So for that, we had to show them the love and compassion, caring, support. That's exactly what our community did, where they were given a chance to expunge their record of felony conviction, do the community service and get over with it. So that's exactly what we're talking about, is forgiveness. Now, a divine and enlightened person is divine, I told you. The enlightened person with no ego, Nirankari, says, as was Prasanna saying in the beginning, who am I to forgive and whom do I forgive? That's what you're saying, Prasanna, right? Because the other person is no different than you are. You see the oneness in that particular individual. So what God is going to forgive, what God? So who am I to forgive? And whom do I forgive? So when you have that understanding, Kshama and forgiveness is kind of a simple word, it's not a correct word, but that feeling has to be much more deeper than that. Because that forgiveness is because if you do the forgive somebody because you think you're superior and somebody has made a mistake, then you are not Kshami. You have not understood what Kshama is. Kshama is something much deeper than that, because it is within the recognition of the fact that you are no different than the person who has made a blunder. You still love that person because you see the same potential in that. And in that process he says, I'm not going to react in a negative way, in a violent way, tough way, because of inappropriate action, because I see the same divinity in you. So basically we finished on the seven things so far. And maybe I'll tell you one story and open up, because we can keep on going otherwise. You can think about worst that can happen to us as a following an action of somebody else is death. That's the worst thing that can happen to us. But the enlightened person can handle that fairly easily, because time revolves the entire creation, you know, kaal. Our knowing one's true nature, which is identical to Brahman, the enlightened person knows that time and dimensions are simply the projections emanating from the breath of God. That's what Veda described. There's a story of a monkey and crocodile. I may have told you many years. All the qualities we described this morning can be brought up in this story. There's a family of monkeys who lived on the banks of the river. And the river had a small island in the middle. And there's a beautiful apple orchard. It was too far to go across that river. So monkeys would not get a chance to eat those apples when they knew they were there. But the crocodile in the water was able to go from one side to another. And that crocodile befriended a baby monkey and would bring one or two apples every day and give to the baby monkey. And baby monkey would be delighted and take it from the crocodile and eat it. It's kind of a vicious story, but I'm going to tell you. And Mrs. Crocodile wanted to eat the heart of a human being, so she enticed Mr. Crocodile to get the heart of a monkey. So Mr. Crocodile gradually convinced that little baby monkey that if you get your mother's heart, I'll take you on the cross to the other side of the river and you can eat the apples to your heart's content. When you are not fully mature, you don't understand how the life should be, and simple temptations become overwhelming. This baby monkey goes ahead, carves out the heart from the mother, and starts walking to the water. And of course, excited as it is because the apples are going to come my way, the baby monkey drops that heart. And the heart cries out. And because monkey fell down, that's how the heart came out of the hand. Are you hurt, sonny? That's mother whose heart is taken out that loving heart of her mother, enlightened as she was, is crying out because the baby failed out. I mean, if you look at the qualities that we discuss in this particular verse, you can connect to all the different qualities we talked about: love, compassion, forgiveness, enlightenment, understanding, friendliness, and forgiveness. Everything is included in that. It's a very graphic story, but I thought I'll tell you that terrible story and will not tell it for another few years. So. Prasanna, come here.
Another verse that comes to my mind in discussing about Bhakta comes in chapter 11, Vishwarupa Darshan Yoga. Bhakta mat karma krit, mat paramo, mat bhakta nirvaira sarva bhutesh. So, a bhakta does everything as a service to God. And he considers God as a supreme being, and he has no enmity towards anybody, treats them with equanimity, samadarshi. So these qualities that you mentioned, which are highlighted in chapter 12, they come all throughout the Bhagavad Gita.
Yeah, that's what
comes in chapter 2, chapter 4,
from 1 through 18.
Chapter 17, chapter 18 is much greater discussion of the bhakta. And the true bhakta does not lose his bhakti if things are not going right for him, nor does the bhakti increase if things are going right for him. Bhakti doesn't, bhakti is bhakti, is how you look at it. Once you make a commitment to God that I have the offering everything, I'm your servant, I'm your instrument, it's not, I'm chosen to do, you've given me the, you've blessed me with the skills to serve, and so it's not mine really, it's yours. And whatever comes out, it's also yours. Nothing is. That quality, as you very correctly pointed out right at the beginning, is not something that you get snap of the finger. It is something that has to be thought about, that has to be practiced, that has to be experienced. Over a period of time, you recognize that bhakti or the devotion that you have towards God will help you in times of distress, like artharthi, arthi, times of distress. You don't know where to go, but if you have faith in God, it will not shake you. So, bhakti is not something that you transact with God. As you correctly pointed out in artharthi, you give me all of these things, I'll put $10 in the mundi. You give me this, I'll give you that. There's no bargaining here. It's an understanding of who you really are and what your relationship to the universal consciousness is. So bhakti is a difficult topic. People say karma yoga is difficult. Jnana yoga, forget it. I don't know Sanskrit, I don't have a teacher, very hard. Raja yoga, that's also very hard. Bhakti yoga is very easy. All you have to do is just sing, shravana, hear, think about it, and shrink, kirtan. Then you are a bhakta. That's only a very small part of that. It is not the whole thing. The bhakti yogi, by definition, is a jnana yogi. Bhakti yogi, mat karma krit, is by definition a karma yogi. So people will say karma yoga is easy, bhakti yoga is very easy, jnana yoga is very difficult.
Right. They know what they're talking about.
That's true.
Ultimately, they all lead to the same thing. Shankaracharya was a Gnani, no question about it. He was also a great Bhakta. Look at all the wonderful stotras that he has created about all the female goddesses, Saraswati, Lakshmi, Ishvara, great Bhakti. So you cannot divorce Jnana from Bhakti.
You can, the two sides of the same coin.
Yeah, you cannot do, you cannot divorce them. So how do I become a Bhakta? Very simple. When you go to bed, offer a prayer to God that today went well and I did the best I possibly could. There were certain things that didn't go right, but I will do my best not to repeat them, correct them. When you get up in the morning, you say, thank you very much for giving me a good night's sleep. And I look forward to this day. Support me, encourage me, help me to get through this day. Once you have that prayer, you automatically become a Bhakta. It's amazing how much it helps you. Look in the eyes of God, darshan. I'm going to the temple for darshan, to look at God. Darshan means not only to look at God's eyes, but also to be seen by God.
Exactly.
To be seen by God means that you have sincerity in your heart when you're looking at God. You're not asking for anything. It's like when you look at a child, look at the child's eyes, and then how your face lights up. It's like that. But if you look at the child or somebody else with some ulterior motive, then your face doesn't light up. So that's the idea that I constantly practice. Never forget God. Sometimes you forget because you're so busy doing our things. We have no time. Don't interfere with me now. You know, I'm too busy. But at least at the end of the day, acknowledge the privilege that you had for living one day. When you get up in the morning, request another day to be better, to be the same or better than the previous one. That's how you develop bhakti towards God. Adveshta sarva bhutana maitraha karuna evacha nirmamo nirahankaraha samadukha sukha kshami. Samatvam. When you have samatvam, you have no I-ness. You have no ego. When you have kshama, you don't have my-ness. Mamatvam. So kshama, if you are endowed with kshama, you give up mamatvam. If you are endowed with sama, samatvam, then you give up, you give away your ego or ahankara.
Exactly. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think the seven qualities is something that is worth, you know, in an encapsulated form.
Which one?
Put on these seven qualities that you mentioned are something, I mean, and they, I know that they are not just singular qualities. They're all
interconnected.
Seven of them really are helpful.
7 out of 39 I've done so far.
Right. Okay. Well, I'm just going to concentrate bit by bit.
Sure, that's
but
fine.
These seven speak to me because I think there's something that I can put on the fridge just once in a while as a reminder how to live in this world, how to behave in this world, etc. We all need those guidelines, not just when we're children that need to be corrected, but always. But I just want to concentrate on one of them, that forgiveness, and it's, I know forgiveness is just one word, it implies so much more, but just yesterday I was watching a movie called Jasper, Texas.
Okay.
This is, in 1998, you know that James Byrd, who was chained, you know, by two supremacists or very bigoted young men. An equally brutal story as your monkey story, but you know, and when and he was chained to a truck and then pulled apart and whatnot, and you know his father, and then this supremacist father, at the very end of the story, He said, I'm sorry, I did not raise my child to do this kind of thing. I don't know what happened in his life, but I say sorry to you, to that particular father. And he touched him. I mean, a white man touching a black man or whatever it is. It was not done in that southern place. And then he equally stopped him and said, you know, we both lost our sons because he was given the capital punishment. And, you know, it just brought tears to my eyes to how they reconciled and how many qualities each of them had to do this, to, you know, to forgive each other for whatever it is, to want to accept the fact that his son is going to be punished. And he did such a brutal thing, and that this father is giving him, forgiveness or a sorry, and which meant so much to him. And so, you know, it just reminds me that so many people have so many qualities that allow them to be this way, and we all want to be this way, and we're not always. When somebody does something to you, your reaction is, oh, you know, that was not nice, or whatever. Even if you don't have revenge in mind to give back, you still feel hurt and wounded. It seems like if you are balanced in your sukha-dukha, etc., you shouldn't even be feeling it to any extent. Exactly. You know? So, I mean, there's a lot to learn from these.
Well, absolutely. That's why there's been slowly rather than giving too much of eating. Shrikant is good, but not too much. as a matter of fact, one thing about that, we have not seen that movie, but I have read the story about it. The reason why you forgive, Naina, is that's the best treatment for you. You let it go. Because if you keep it within yourself, that keeps on gnawing at you. It continues to produce antibodies in your body, which are not healthy for you. So by letting it go, by forgiving somebody, you're trying to close the chapter the best possible way we can. So I think his reaction was really an enlightened one. But even when somebody comes to for counseling, that's what we suggest to them, that basically that's the best treatment you can do. But otherwise, that anger, the revengeful attitude continues to eat up that individual who has suffered the negative experiences. How about just singing the 12th chapter? Okay? Get that. Vasudeva satam devam
vasudeshanuramardhanam devati paramanandam krishnam vande jagadguram vashuvadhyayam sadhuvatiyogaram vashuvadhyayam satatayuktayevatastvam varyupasate ये चाप्यक्षरमव्यक्तं देशाम्केयोगविन्तमान् जीवमाच मय्यावेश्यमनो ये मां निर्ययुक्तास्पासते श्रद्धया परयोपेतास्ते मे युक्तधर्मामता ये त्वक्षरमनिन्देश्यं अव्यक्तं परियुपासते निवशिष्यसि मयि एव अथ ऊर्ध्वः संशयः
sarva bhutanam maitra karuneva cha nirmano nirankara samasukha karshami santushta satatam yogi yatatma drudhanishchaya maya vipitamano buddhir yomad bhakta samekriya yasmano vijite loko lokano vijite cha harshama shabayo dvegai mukto yasa cha me priya anapeksha shuchir daksha udasi no gatavyata sarvarambha parityagi yomad bhakta samekriya yo nanushyati nadveshi nashochati nakamchati shubhashava parityagi bhaktimanyasya samekriya samashatrau cha mitre cha tatha manapamanayo shintoshta sadukheshu samasanga vivarjita tulya nindasi tirmauni santo